discourse on the impact of vernacular education. This has been going on for a very long time in Malaysia, but it gets continually brought to the fore. And I think what we see is consternation from many parents about the protection of their child's education in their mother tongue, and of course concerns about the different quality of education that you see in the many different types of government school. But if we look at the private sector, I think one important development is that there has been a very big growth in schools in the private sector, especially in the last few years. I think this is partly to do with the Prime Minister's transformation programs, and he has liberalized the sector somewhat. And I think someone was telling me yesterday, the number of licenses granted to build new international schools has been tremendous in the last year or two. The biggest challenge across the board is to maintain a minimum degree of quality between the various different types of schools. There's a huge disparity in the quality of education being offered across these schools, and also there is a huge diversity in what is being taught in the schools and the methods employed. I'm not saying that's necessarily a bad thing. I like to see more diversity. I think, you know, more parental choice is fundamentally a good thing. But the diversity I've seen doesn't reflect a sense of a national vision. And I think that will lead to the next generation of Malaysians growing up with very different ideas about what our country, about where our country is headed. And I think that's quite an important trend to nip in the bud. And we do that via reforming the education sector. In many ways, Malaysia has already begun that process of becoming that regional hub. Many sort of foreign institutions of higher learning have opened up in Malaysia, I think beginning with Nottingham and Monash, and now you have Curtin, you have Newcastle and a couple of others opening up in the Iskandar region in Johor. But I think what's very important is to ensure its sustainability. I think Malaysia cannot rest on its laurels and just say and have the attitude that, oh, since they're opening up, they will be here forever. I don't think that's necessarily the case. I think the government, or whichever government is in power in future, needs to ensure that the higher education sector is sufficiently liberalized so that these operators can run, these universities can operate in this country without too much interference. One of the reasons to make this higher education hub idea really sustainable is also to convince Malaysian students that these developments are for them, right? One of the grumblings I've already heard is that the presence of all these international higher education institutions is not for the benefit of Malaysians. It's to attract already affluent sectors in Singapore and Hong Kong and other countries in the region, which will of course create resentment amongst the Malaysian population, because, you know, ultimately it is the Malaysian government which has allowed these or indeed invited these institutions to come. So Malaysians don't get the benefit. Understandably, there might be some consternation at that. So I would say that in order to make it sustainable, it is essential that Malaysian students get the opportunity to attend these institutions and get the benefits out of those institutions. But another, perhaps more subtle benefit would be that the domestic education sector also needs to be liberalized so that they can compete with these international institutions. I mean, on the other side, I have heard complaints from local education providers who say that they are being discriminated against because the foreign operators are being given all sorts of incentives to come here and to open, but the local education providers are not. And I think it's very important that there is a more level playing field on both sides.